Hello and welcome to Civil Engineering Mathematics A. My name is Eric Chun and I'm a lecturer in mathematics at Central TAFE. This is program 5. Well, in this program we continue with algebra. In the previous program we looked at types of numbers, we looked at signed numbers and we looked at algebraic expressions. Now we're going to work with these algebraic expressions, and in fact towards the end of this program we already will do some quite interesting applications of algebra. Well, let's have a look what exactly will be covered in this program. First thing we're going to do is substitution. Then we look at simplifying expressions. Removing brackets is next. Linear equations, they're quite important. And then word problems, and they can become quite difficult. Well, let's look at that first topic then, substitution. You have to know your algebraic rules before you can do substitution. Substitution is very important in engineering because you come across lots of formulae and you have to put values in those formulae. If you can't substitute in simple algebraic expressions, you will find that process very difficult in engineering. Let's have a look at what substitution is. We substitute a value, that means we assign a variable, we assign a value to a variable, and so we can then, can then evaluate the literal expression. Let's have a look at an example. I've got minus 3x plus 1. That becomes minus 2 or negative 2 when x is equal to 1. It becomes a different value when x is equal to 0. It in fact becomes 1, and again a different value when x is equal to negative 2. So you have to know those rules. See that negative 2 times the negative 3, that becomes a positive 6, add a 1, and then you get the 7. Let's have a look at some problems, an easy one first and then a more difficult one. Evaluate those two expressions. First of all, 2x squared minus 4 for x equals minus 6. Well, here we go. We substitute the minus 6 in for the x and we square the minus 6. If you square the minus 6, you get 36. So in the end, we get 2 times 36 subtract 4 equals 68. The next expression, two different values there, x is 2 and y is negative 3. And when you substitute that in, you get a negative or subtract 5 times negative 3. That becomes positive 15. And 2 plus 15 plus 6 is, of course, equal to 23. The next topic is about simplifying expressions. But before we can do that, we have to know something about the terminology involved. There is, in fact, a lot of terminology involved with algebra. Like terms, for instance, is one of those. Let's have a look. A literal expression, such as negative 3x squared y, has one term. It's called a monomial. Do you think of monorail? If it's got two terms, it's called a binomial. Now, an expression such that minus 3x squared y, in fact, has two parts to it. It's got a numerical coefficient, that negative 3, and it's got a literal coefficient. Now, as soon as the literal coefficient is the same in two expressions, you can talk about like terms. And what we can do with like terms is to add and subtract. In fact, that is the golden rule of algebra. Only like terms can be added or subtracted. I've got quite a nice example here why that is. We've got, for instance, dollars to stand D for dollars and C for cents. And if I receive $2 and then $3, in total I've received $5. So we can say $2 plus $3 equals $5. See, we keep that same letter part, but we add those 2 and 3s up to get a 5. Now, if you receive $2 and then 10 cents, you can't do much with it. You have to write it as $2 plus 10 cents. You can't simplify that and make that 20 DC or whatever. It is 2D plus 10C. So this leads then to that important rule of algebra about simplifying expressions. Only like terms can be added or subtracted. It will come up on the screen now. I've called it rule 1. And when you add or subtract, what you have to do is you have to keep the same literal coefficient and you have to add or subtract the numerical coefficient. Let's have a look at an example as usual. Easy example first, and then a more difficult one. 2D plus 10C plus 3D equals, let's look at problem A. Well, we can of course add the 2D to the 3D to get 5D, but we can't do anything more, and we leave that as 10c. In the next problem, 3x minus 5xy minus 2x plus 7xy plus 4, there is a 3x and a minus 2x. I can combine that. I can combine those two there. Can't do anything with the 4. And so the final simplification is x plus 2xy plus 4. When algebraic expressions are multiplied or divided, then you can get a different term. I've got that written down as rule 2. Multiplication or division of algebraic terms produces terms with a different literal coefficient. Let's look straight away at an example of that. I've got 2d times 10c in problem A. Well, I can split up the 2d as 2 times d and to change the d with the 10, because I can always say 3 times 5 is 5 times 3, so multiplication can always be interchanged. Then the answer becomes 20dc. See, I've got a new literal coefficient there out of d multiplied by c. Slightly more difficult problem with division. I can certainly divide the negative 30 by the negative 5 to give me 6. It's an x to the power of 4 divided by an x. That would give me x to the power of 3. And then the answer becomes 6x cubed. Now, brackets are always encountered in algebraic expressions, and you have to be aware how to simplify those. I've got it illustrated by means of an area calculation. See if you can follow this. I hope so. If I had to calculate the area of this triangle or this rectangle, I could multiply 5 by 3 to get 15, but I would not quite know what this area is. It would be 5 times whatever x is. Now, if I write that down algebraically, then I can say the area is 5 times x plus 5 times 3. 5 times 3 is 15, so I can write it as 5x plus 15. But I could have also done the multiplication by taking 5 and multiplying it direct by x plus 3. And therefore, those two expressions must be the same. So what you see is that that 5 is actually distributed among the x and among the 3 to produce 5x plus 15. Now, formally, that's written down in the rule with A, B, and C, etc., and that's what we've got on the screen coming up. And we're using those letters then, AB plus AC. It's officially called the distributive property. When you have negative numbers, then, of course, that's going to affect things. If it's a negative 1 in front of these brackets, that's really a negative 1. We don't write that negative 1, we just write the negative sign, but that distributes as well, so it becomes negative b and then negative c. Also, when we've got a negative b minus c, it becomes a negative b, but that negative makes that one positive, and so we get negative b plus c. In fact, what we say with brackets, if there's a negative in front of the bracket, then every term inside the bracket changes sign. Let's look at some problems again. Here are the problems. Simplify, remove brackets and simplify. 3x plus 2 brackets x take away y. Take away 5, sorry. So we've got 3x, leave it like that, 2 times x, and then 2 times negative 5. That produces 2x, take away 10. We can now simplify the 3x and the 2x to make it 5x. That's the final answer. For the second one, a lot of negatives there. That will change all these signs there. So simplifying it, we get negative 6x, we get plus 3y, carry the 3 through, then negative 2x, that changes the sign to a negative, becomes 14y plus 8, then we combine all these terms together into negative 8x, subtract 11y plus 8. You've now been introduced to a variety of algebraic techniques and operations, but you have to practice that. You have to be really competent at it. In your book, there are plenty of exercises on elementary algebra. Please go to your book and practice. Now, after the break, we come back with one of the more important applications of algebra, solving linear equations. In engineering, we frequently encounter situations where we have to solve for an unknown value to work out, for instance, the strength of a beam. What we do is we let that unknown value be x and solve a problem. Now, we can only solve very simple problems called linear equations. An equation, in fact, is a statement with an is equal in it, and a linear equation hasn't got any powers like squares or square roots. That's what I've got on the screen here. A linear equation, an equation is a statement with an equality sign, and a linear equation hasn't got any powers. It can be written in the form AX plus B. The highest power, we say, is equal to 1. Well, let's see how that works in some problems. Can we actually find whether these equations are linear or not? Well, the first one certainly is. There is no higher power of 1 involved. It's just 2 times x, x to the power of 1, so it's linear, with, in fact, the value a being 2 and b equals 7 in that previous formula. But the second one, you see the highest power there is a 2, so that's what's called a quadratic. We can't solve those as yet, but one day we will. X equals 7 doesn't look like one of those linear equations, but it certainly is, unusual situation. And then the next one, the square root of x plus 7 equals 0. Well, the square root of x, later we will learn that that is the same as x to the power and half, so that is not 1. Consequently, it is not a linear equation. Now, how do we solve linear equations? There are basically 2 techniques involved. First one is called cross-multiplication. The next one is called transposition. I've got an illustration example of this first technique called cross-multiplication. Let's see if you can follow this. Let X be the cost of an ice cream. If 5 ice creams cost $4.50, then 5x equals $4.50, or x equals $4.50 divided by 5. I'm actually not interested in the answer. But you see what happens. The 5 is multiplied by x to get an answer. I divide by 5. This is a little bit more general. Let 5 ice creams cost C dollars, then 5x equals C dollars, or x equals C dollars divided by 5. And in fact, I can buy any number of ice creams, A ice creams, that cost C dollars, then it's the same process. So X is equal to C dollars over A. Now that brings us to the general rule which I've got written up next. That is called the cross multiplication rule, coming up right now. If AX equals C, then X is C on A. So it's a multiplication, it becomes a division, just illustrated earlier with these ice creams. So what we actually do is crossing on the is equal sign. You know, you cross like this. And that's what we've got written down here. See, that's that cross multiplication. Well, as usual, we're going to have some problems on that. Let's have a look. Cross multiplication problem. We've got solve 5x plus 10, and we've got negative x on 3 equals 6. Well, the first problem, we cross the 5 over, and then obviously we get x equals 10 divided by 5 equals 2. For the next problem, we cross the 3 over to make it 18. Slight complication, because we're going to get negative x equals 18. We want the answer as x equals, so we change and divide by negative 1 to get negative 18. Now, you can always check by substitution that you've done that correctly, because if you substitute negative 18 into that equation, you got a negative and a negative that make a positive. 18 on 3 equals 6. Now, the other technique, there were 2, remember, cross multiplication. The other one is called transposition, and also a very important one. In short, it says change sides, change signs. Let's see how that works. I've got an example here, again, with ice creams. Well, actually, let the cost be of an ice cream. If you add $5 to that, then and the total is $5.90, then you can write that mathematically as x plus $5 equals $5.90, but then x is going to be equal to $5.90 minus $5.90. In general, of course, if we use p and q, you get this equation, x plus p dollars equals q dollars, then x is the difference between q dollars and p dollars. Now, if we write that in terms of a general rule, we get the following. Second rule, if x plus q equals p, then x is p minus q. And also, if x minus q equals p, then x equals p plus q. Now, what happens? Have a look. If I have a plus q there and I want x on its own, I can bring that q to the other side, it becomes a negative q. If it's a negative q, I can bring it to the other side, it becomes positive q. We call that a transposition. And here we've got it. Change sides, change signs. Well, as usual, let's have a look at a few problems, how that works in practice. Transposing problems, solve x minus 3 equals 7. First of all, bring the negative 3 to the other side, becomes positive 7, positive 3, sorry, and that becomes a total of 10. You can always check by substitution, 10 minus 3 equals 7. And the next problem, 6 minus x equals 11, and then of course 6 minus 11 equals x. Consequently, negative 5 equals x, or minus 5 equals x, or x equals minus 5. And again, check by substitution. Now, what needs to be done first? If you have a situation where you have to do cross multiplication and transposition, well, there are some rules there, and I'll go quickly through those. Let's have a look. Rule 3, I can call it. You should really transpose first before cross multiplication. And I've got another rule on the screen here. Bring like terms together. Time for an example straight away. If you have to solve the following equations, 2x plus 3 equals 7, then what do you have to do? Well, like I said before, 2x plus 3 equals 7. Do the transposing first to make it 2x equals 4. Then do the cross multiplication. So divide 4 by 2 to get 2. Second problem. 6 take away x equals 21 plus 5x, transpose first, put the x's to one side, the numbers to the other side, and so we get a total of negative 6x equals 15, then we divide 15 by negative 6, and we get negative 2.5. There are two rules, two other rules I want to briefly mention. The first one deals with brackets, the next one deals with fractions. Let's first of all look at the one about brackets. Rule 5. It says if you have brackets, you should really get rid of them at the beginning. Remove them at the beginning. The rule about the fraction goes like this. When you see fractions, try multiplying by the LCD. Now that stands for lowest common denominator. I think this is best illustrated by examples. Here we've got an example with brackets there, 2 brackets, x plus 3 equals 7. First of all, we remove the brackets by multiplying the 2 by x and the 2 by the 3 to get 2x plus 6 equals 7. And then we solve in the normal manner. 2x equals 7 take away 6 by means of transposing, so 2x equals 1, x must be in half. The second problem, you see a 2 there in the bottom. That is called the lowest common denominator. If I multiply this whole part by 2 and that whole part by 2, I remove the fraction. Here we go. The lowest common denominator is 2, so I put 2 in front. I get 2 lots of x over 2. Well, that's simply equal to x because the 2 cancels against the 2. The 2 times 1 equals 2. And finally, the 2 times the negative 2 gives me negative 4. I'm back to one of those familiar equations. X plus 2 equals negative 4 means x equals negative 6. So far, we've covered some very easy problems. Let's finish this section with a slightly more difficult one. I hope you can follow it. Here we've got 2x take away 1 over 2 plus 3 equals negative 2 on 3 times x plus 2. So we have to do the brackets. First of all, however, I see a 2 and a 3, which is called the lowest common denominator, a 6. I'll multiply everything by 6. If I do that, I will end up with 3 brackets 2x take 1 plus 18. Remember, it's 6 times 3 equals, and then we get 6 lots of negative 2 on 3. Well, that's negative 4 brackets x plus 2. So I've gotten rid of the fraction signs there. Very important. Next screen. I've got the same statements that I had before. Now I get rid of the brackets multiplying through. Then I have to collect the terms because I've got 6x takes 3 plus 18. That can be combined in plus 15. Bring x's to one side, numbers to the other side, so I transpose, negative 4x goes to that side, becomes positive 4x, and the 15 goes to the other side, becomes negative 15. Finally, simplifying that becomes 10x equals negative 23, and the last step is the cross multiplication. And the answer, therefore, is negative 2.3. Now, I hope you agree with me, that is a very difficult problem, and you have to go through it step by step and practice from your book some of these problems. Well, after the break, we come back with word problems. In word problems, we have to form the equation from the information given. So there might be quite a lengthy sentence, and you have to extract the algebra from that. There's a procedure which I've indicated here on the next slide. The first step would be to determine the unknown quantity and choose a logical letter to represent it. I think that's quite important. A diagram also would help. Write the equation, then you solve the equation just like we've done before, and then lastly you have to give the answer using the correct units. That is very important. As usual, some examples straight into it. Here we've got a fully loaded jet that prior to takeoff carries 160,000 kilograms of fuel, people and luggage. Now its weight is 325,000 kilograms. What is the empty plane's weight? Now, it's a lot of information there. How can we solve that problem? Well, we let the empty plane's weight be W, a logical letter, as I've said before. So we let that be W. Then we know that W plus the 660,000 must be equal to 325,000. Here I've got my equation. Then I solve that by transposition to get W equal 165,000, and then finally I put it in the correct units. The weight of the empty plane is 165,000 kilogram. That's a very straightforward problem, although you know you have to do a bit of thinking about it. The next problem is a little bit more difficult. Here Bill originally had $54 and saved $12 per month until he had $150. For how many months did he save? Well, we let the number of months be M, a logical letter. Then we get this equation, the $54 he had originally plus 12M, because every month he saves 12, so it's 12 times M, and the total he wants is 150. We get the linear equation. Transposition first, 12m is 150 minus 54, and that works out to 96. Divide finally 96 by 12 to get 8. Put the correct units down, in this case it's month, so Bill saved for 8 months. A little bit more difficult. The next problem, you really have to do some thinking. Here we go, problem number 3. In this problem, we've got a rectangle that is twice as long as it is wide. The perimeter is 48 centimeters. Find the width and then the area. Here we deal with two letters, W for the width and A for the area. Let's have a look. What do we know? Well, we know that the length is 2 times the width, so I've got length equals 2W, but I also know that the perimeter is 48. Now, in terms of the perimeter formula for a rectangle, it's always 2 lots of length plus breadth, so in this case it becomes 2 lots of W plus 2W, which is 6W. So I got 48 equals 6W. From that, I can get, of course, what W is, the width, that's 8. Now, then, if you draw a little diagram, you can get the width as 8. We know that the length must be twice as long, so that's 16. Consequently, the area becomes 8 times 60 equals 128. There's just enough time for one more problem. Let's have a look. Problem 4. We've got the total takings at a football match is 195,390. Adults pay $22 and children 12. And there are 3 times as many adults. Let n be the number of children. Then we've got 12 times n, because n is the number of children. They pay $12, 3 times as many adults as children, so that's 3n, they pay 22, that comes to that amount. Simplify, that comes to 78, n equals 195,390, divide through and give the answer, of course, in the correct units, 2,505 children. You will agree with me that you have to practice this work. Well, it's done in chapter 6 in your book, and please do as many problems as you can. I hope that you found this program useful. I'm looking forward to your company in program 6. Bye for now.